Dr. Steve Devor, and he was my former professor, so I have a hard time calling him Steve, but Dr. Steve Devor. And he is a assistant professor, faculty member over in PAES, which is right next door. I'll let him give you a little bit of backdrop on him himself if he wants to. He also is the executive director of the faculty and staff fitness program, and Emily back here is the program manager for that program, and also the exercise physiologist for the Commit to Be Fit.
Right, in Columbus, yeah.
Stuff, yeah. So if you have any questions on that, Steve is, of course, going to answer. And we are going to videotape, but please ask questions. Come on in. Hi there.
Well, hi, everyone. Thanks for this capacity crowd here. I gave this talk last December, and it was apparently very, very popular, so they wanted me to do it again. But maybe it wasn't as popular as we thought. So at any rate, my name's Steve Devor, and I'm a professor, associate professor, in PAS doesn't actually exist anymore.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
We're now in the Department of Human Sciences, and I'm in the kinesiology program, and I have a joint appointment in physiology and cell biology over at the medical school, where we shoot people if they smoke, apparently. So what I'd like to talk to you about is exercise as medicine and writing a prescription. And really, that's the way that we think about it as exercise physiology. Exercise really can be used as a preventative tool, as a medicine. And that's true, and there's a tremendous amount of data to support that. But then, okay, if that's true, though, with a medicine, you get a prescription from your physician. So how do you write the prescription for exercise? Because most people get their medical advice from their physician. Most physicians don't really understand all that well how to prescribe exercise. So that's where exercise physiologists come in. And quite honestly, this idea of exercise being medicine is something that we sort of got started anyway. So just a little roadmap of what I'm going to talk about today. I first would like to talk a little bit about physical inactivity, being physically inactive, and why this is truly a national health emergency. It's not something that we just need to have on the radar. This is something that truly is a major, it's probably, without exaggerating, the number one public health crisis in this country. Not obesity, physical inactivity, because physical inactivity leads to obesity. It's a definite contributor for it. So it's a national health emergency. So then I'd like to talk about the health problems that are directly related to physical inactivity, being physically inactive. And as you'll see, I don't mean some circuitous route to kind of eventually get you there. I mean, you're physically inactive, you're much more likely to get this. It's a direct line. Then I'd like to talk about what are the elements of an exercise program. So this is the prescription part. So now you understand, okay, I need to move around more, I need to be active. Well, what do I do? What is aerobic exercise? What is resistance training? How much of it should I be doing? When, where, that kind of thing. And if I haven't convinced you all by then, the last part of what I want to talk about today is truly the medical importance of exercise. And this is what normally hits home for people. And I'll show you some data that's very, very striking that will really make it clear that it really is the number one thing that you can do to be unhealthy is not be active. It really is that simple. So let's start with inactivity being a national health emergency. So we know that adults, this is based on a study that was published in 2003. It was a sampling of 152,000 people across America. Big epidemiological study. Adults were classified as 18 to 59. That was just the range they used. So 18-year-olds up to 59-year-olds. What we found is that only 3.5% of that population sample exercised regularly. Regularly was defined as 3 to 4 days a week, 20 to 25 minutes. You all, I will tell you, that's not even what the American College of Sports Medicine considers to be the minimum dose. And only 3.5% of the population met that definition of regular. 40% of the people that responded were completely sedentary, no physical activity at all. We know that sedentary behavior increases with age. When people get to be 60 or older, their level of activity tends to go down. In that group, we know only 2.5% of the population exercises regularly. So a complete percent drop. This is a major, major problem. For far too many people in this country, this is their idea of the Stairmaster. So you've got the guy sitting on his couch, you know, going from CNN to ESPN on the remote control. And the cat is going, wow, 3.5 hours on the Stairmaster. For way too many people, this is their idea of exercise. It's just sort of sitting around and not really doing much at all. So we know that humans were designed to be active. I mean, initially people were we lived in a very hunter-gatherer society, whereas I like to say you were either on the run to get food or on the run to not become food, right? So people basically were physically active all day long. They were moving around all the time. Not high, super high intensity exercise, not measuring heart rates, not concerned about VO2s. They just moved around all day, hunter-gatherer society. Then we became a very agrarian society in this country. Many of our grandparents worked on farms, worked with heavy machinery. They were very active all day. The idea, I often think, like, what would my grandfather have thought of a modern gym? People going into this thing and like working really hard on all these machines. He would have said, well, why are you, let's go like get something done, like actually productive with all this energy that you're expending. So that's what people used to get their work from, their actual manual labor. And then we became a very, as you all know, very industrialized society, the cotton mill, things like that. But people still worked with heavy machinery. They were still active, but there's no doubt there was a drop from an agrarian society to a more industrialized society. And what we live into today produces way too many people that look like this. You just sit at your desk all day long. Everything is done for you. It's a point, it's a click, it's a remote control. People just don't move around much, very much at all. People send an email to someone whose office is literally 10 steps away, rather than just imagine this, getting up out of your chair and going to talk to that individual. Human interaction, physical activity, it's all good. But you guys all know what I mean. We all do that. I'm guilty of that. Everything is done for you in a very computerized society. Now, I'm not saying I want to go back to running away from saber-toothed tigers, but all of these advances have no doubt resulted in a decreased amount of exercise and physical activity on a daily basis. We simply don't move enough. We just don't move around as much anymore, and that has resulted in a lot of health problems that are directly related to being physically inactive, being physically inactive. So physical inactivity we know leads to, these are ones that are just indisputable from the data in the literature. Obesity, type 2 diabetes, hypertension, high blood pressure, dyslipidemia. What I mean by dyslipidemia, for those of you that don't know, high cholesterol, high LDL, low HDL, exactly what you don't want. High triglycerides, dyslipidemia. Your lipids are not where they should be. So physical inactivity leads to all that. My clinician friends lump this all together and they call it Syndrome X or Metabolic Syndrome or Metabolic Syndrome X, depending on the journal that you're reading, depending on the clinician that you're talking to. Because all these things sort of feed on to one another. If you're obese, you're much more likely to have diabetes. If you're obese, you're much more likely to have hypertension. If you're obese, you're much more likely to have dyslipidemia. Dyslipidemia feeds hypertension. So all these things, it's sort of this negative feedback loop. And many people have all of these and take different pharmaceutical agents, different drugs for all of them. Every drug that we have typically works fairly well, but every drug has a side effect. Doesn't matter what it is. Caffeine, aspirin, the most benign drugs that we all use, they all have, anything you put in your body has a side effect. It's that simple. So these are called metabolic syndrome X. But we also know that physical inactivity leads to cardiovascular disease without question, and two other things that are on people's radar as well, both osteoarthritis and osteoporosis. And I think when many men hear osteoporosis, they think, oh, I'm a man, I don't need to worry about that. No, osteoporosis is no more the exclusive domain of men than cardiovascular disease, or the exclusive domain of women, than cardiovascular disease just belongs to men. Men get osteoporosis, women get cardiovascular disease. These things cut across sexes, it's not owned by any one group of people. So all of these things, you guys, are directly caused by people being physically inactive. Again, it's not this circuitous route that gets us there. We know if you're physically inactive, your likelihood of getting any one or all of these is greatly increased just by moving less. It's that simple. So, and obesity is really where all this starts. So you've all probably seen something like this before. This is data from the Center for Disease Control. This is the 2010 data. But in 1995, let me start going back even just that far, the obesity rates in all 50 states were less than 20%. So what I mean by that is you go to any state in 1995, sample any, even states in the South, which are typically worse, sample any state in the 48 contiguous states, including in the other two as well, Alaska and Hawaii, all 50 states, the obesity rates were less than 20%, meaning you take that state, less than 20% of the population in that state was obese. You fast forward to 2000, there were only 28 states that were less than 20%. You go to 2005, only 4 states were less than 20%. 3 states were greater than 30% in 2005. In 2010, which is the most recent good data set we have, there's data from ensuing years, but 2010 is complete. In 2010, there was no state less than 20%. So in a 15-year span, all 50 states were under, In 2010, no state was less than 20%. 12 states were greater than 35%. I will tell you guys that the data that I've seen from 2012, which is the most recent CDC data, there is no state that is less than 25% obese, and there are a dozen states that are 40% or higher, the obesity rate. A dozen that are 40% or higher. This is not going away, it's only getting worse. And it's really slow and very insidious, and it's what we call creeping obesity. And what I mean by that is this. Again, it's a major public health crisis. I'm not minimizing this. I'm not criticizing my friends in the James. And we spend a lot of money in Stephanie and, oh my goodness, pink everything. Obesity is a way bigger problem, no pun intended, than any cancer. It's the most important public health crisis that we have. And it often goes unnoticed because it's a creeping thing. 30 extra calories a day. 30 extra calories a day. That's about a third of a small apple. So all of you, you know, are familiar with Panera. So you may or may not know, when you go to Panera, order a sandwich, order a soup, you don't have to get chips or another piece of bread. You can get an apple. You can ask for an apple. Now, the apple that they give you are those small, little, decrepit apples that no one would ever buy for themselves in the market. I don't know where they even get all these little, decrepit apples from. The apples that nobody loves, that's what I call them. And they give you this little, tiny, decrepit, small apple. A third of a small apple, that's like 2 bites, right? A third of a small apple is 30 calories. This is not a lot of food. That's the point I'm trying to make. 30 extra calories a day is a 3-pound weight gain in a year. 30 unchecked calories in a day. A third of a small apple, 365 days later, you gain 3 pounds. And you might think, oh, what's the big deal? It's 3 pounds. It's over the course of a year. No big deal. Well, you guys, the problem is 5 years later, it's 15 pounds, right? 10 years later, you know, you're 10 years out of high school, you're 10 years down the road, and you're 30 pounds over ideal, now you're considered obese. And it doesn't have, people don't wake up one day and all of a sudden they're wearing gigantic sized clothes. It happens very slowly. It's very insidious, and it doesn't take, excuse me, many unchecked calories to gain weight. Now, having said that, you have this 30 extra calories a day, burning that many extra calories doesn't require a lot of effort either. It requires going up 3 flights of steps one time a day. Boom, there's your 30 calories. Not a lot of extra walking, but people tend to not do that. They take the elevator. The elevator is the devil. Never take the elevator, it breaks. Just take the steps. I know they're in every building, it's fire code. Always use the steps. There's no excuse to use the elevator. Be more active, just move around more. So this metabolic syndrome, Max, we know that too much of this leads to this fella right here. This is TMI, as my son says, too much information, put a shirt on. So, and this, there's very high likelihood that this gentleman, well, we know he has obesity. There's a very high likelihood that he has type 2 diabetes as well, that he's hypertense, he probably has dyslipidemia. We know that being more active, riding a bike, swimming, running, walking, playing soccer, playing tennis, taking the steps, hand washing my car, not going through Moomoo, moving around more can completely eliminate this thing. You guys, I'm very fortunate. I work with a number of sports medicine doctors in Columbus, and I can recount to you story after story after story of people who come in, they're obese, they're on some sort of a statin for cholesterol, they're on this drug for hypertension, And we get them to move around more, lose 20 or 30 pounds, and they either completely eliminate the medicine they're taking or the dose of it that they're taking goes way down. Exercise is medicine, and there's no copay for it. Right? Exercise is free. Just go outside and walk. I mean, it doesn't have to be fancy exercise. You don't need all the fancy tight clothes. You don't need to join a gym. Just go outside and move. That's all you need to do. It's free. And it really does get rid of a lot of these things, or greatly reduces their severity. So for example, let me talk about just a couple of them. Type 2 diabetes. This typically begins as insulin resistance, which means that the glucose receptor, glucose is sugar in your bloodstream, that glucose receptor that's on your cells is not as responsive to insulin because your body is always seeing a lot of insulin, so your receptors just start to go, well, I always see this, I don't need to respond to insulin. It's like you have a clock in your house that chimes, you don't even hear it anymore because it's still chiming, it's still making the sound, but you just become non-receptive to it because it's always there. That's the same sort of thing with the glucose receptor. It doesn't respond to insulin. We call that insulin resistant. If you're insulin resistant long enough, what your body does is, well, okay, you're not responding to this insulin, my blood sugar is still high, I'll pump out more insulin. So insulin levels go up, they go up, they go up. And after a number of years, what happens is more insulin just keeps getting released. The beta cells in the pancreas eventually just necrose. They die. It's not doing any good. I'm putting out a lot of insulin. This organism is not responding to it. And the cells just literally burn themselves out. That's the way to think about it. They become necrotic. They die. Type 2 diabetes results from this. We know that in 2005, there were 1.5 million new cases of diagnosed type 2 diabetes in this country. That's the ones that have been diagnosed in 2005. And notice that the largest age group is where most of us live. 40 to 59 is where the biggest growth, if you will, in the number of diabetes cases are. But again, it's not the exclusive domain of 40 to 59 year olds. Look at the number of people that are 60 plus, and alarmingly, the number of college age students, 17, 18, 19, 20, and into your early part of your work career, this kind of group right here, big increase in the number of diabetes, of diagnoses, and people that are just not responding well to insulin, which again is directly related to a lack of physical activity. So we know that exercise increases caloric expenditure, which can cause you to lose weight, assuming that you're eating a little less. We know that muscle contraction, which is what exercise is, it causes your skeletal muscles to contract, that causes that glucose receptor to respond. You don't even need insulin. When people are exercising, glucose goes out of the bloodstream into the muscle cells, but your insulin levels are very close to zero. So how is that glucose getting into the muscle cell? The contraction of the muscle itself brings the glucose in. So we know that the muscle contraction causes that glucose receptor to respond, so blood glucose goes down without insulin, and if you do this enough, the medicinal amount of insulin that you need to take goes down. So people that are insulin resistant, one of the best things they can do is walk more. Muscle contraction. Just move around more and your blood glucose levels will go down without even taking insulin at all. So that's if you're insulin resistant though. If you've already kicked into what we call full-blown diabetes, then it's too late. Then you're going to be shooting insulin or you're going to have a pump on. But when you're insulin resistant, you're on your way, people should be prescribed exercise. Move around more. So obese and diabetic patients should definitely be prescribed exercise as a way to help them lower those health risks and their health costs. Physical inactivity and muscle mass loss, this is something that anyone over the age of 45, 50 for certain needs to be concerned about. Loss of muscle mass during the aging process is very well documented. It's greatly accelerated by inactivity, particularly when you get past the age of 50. And the primary thing that older adults worry about is their loss of independence. Most older adults, think of your parents, if they're fortunate to still have them, or your grandparents even, they're not concerned about how much they can bench press or how fast they can run a mile. They just want to remain independent. They want to be able to live on their own, carry their own groceries, walk up a flight of steps, what we call the activities of daily living. Bathe themselves, get up off a toilet seat, things like that. The inability to perform daily activities is the primary reason for nursing home care. You guys, as I say to my undergraduate students, the number one reason older adults go to a nursing home isn't because they're about to die, isn't because they have some deathly disease, it's because they can't do this. There it was. Because if you can't do that, if you've lost so much muscle mass that you can't rise up out of a chair, that means you can't get off the toilet seat. That means you can't get out of the bathtub. That means you probably can't walk up a ramp or a flight of steps. It's all related to muscle mass loss. And if you lose muscle mass, you lose independence. And you go from what we call independent living to assisted living. Because you need assistance to do things. And where you're going from assisted living is to a full-on skilled nursing home. That's the last stop. That's when you can't hardly do anything at all for yourself anymore. And it's very sad. It's the number one reason older adults go into a nursing home, because they simply have lost so much muscle mass. Is this going to happen naturally as a part of the aging process? Of course. Can you retard it greatly? Can you slow it down? Can you make the loss less? Absolutely. exercise, moving around more. We'll talk specifically about that. So what are these elements of an exercise program? What do you need to be doing? What is the prescription? So the first thing I want to talk about is aerobic exercise. This is the cardio. This is the rhythmic use of major muscle groups, doing something over and over and over and over again. Walking, running, using a bike, an elliptical, swimming, something rhythmic, over and over and over again. You guys know what I'm talking about. The benefits of this are weight loss, you can help to eliminate type 2 diabetes, it lowers blood pressure, it reduces total cholesterol, it raises HDL, and it lowers LDL. This isn't stuff I'm making up, there's reams of data to support this. No medicines. Just get people moving more with aerobic exercise. We're not even getting to resistance training yet. Just aerobic exercise, you're going to do all of these things right here. Just by being more aerobically active, by moving, and it doesn't need to be high level. Just walking more, taking the steps, parking at the back of the lot. Simple lifestyle things. The modalities for this, again, the different ways you can do this. Everybody kind of knows these, running or walking, biking or indoor cycling, rowing, elliptical trainer, step climbing, fitness classes, anything you like, you guys. Any modality works. It doesn't need to be we're not trying to make athletes out of people. We just want people to move more. We just want people to be more physically active. And if there's one question I get asked a lot as an exercise physiologist, it's, well, Dr. Devor, okay, I get it, I hear you, I want to start doing this aerobic exercise still. But, you know, I'm super busy. What's the most effective way? What's the best way for me to do it? I want the most bang for my buck, and we can sort of all appreciate that, right? So, what's the most effective modality? Well, here's the thing. I can tell you what the most effective modality is from an exercise physiologist perspective. What's going to give you the highest lab value for VO2 max, all these other nerdy things that I'm interested in that we measure in our labs, and Emily and I do. But the most effective modality is the one that you're going to actually do. Because if I tell you that cross-country skiers have the highest VO2 max values, typically have the lowest resting heart rates, or I tell you that running is the most effective modality, it's going to give you the highest lab values, and the only time you like to run is if you're being chased, and then quite honestly, you don't even want to run, you just want to lay down and get caught. Guess what? Running is not the best modality for you because you hate it, you're not going to do it, and then I'm going to turn it right back onto my field. I have failed. I have missed getting another person physically active because I've said, well, if you're not running, to hell with it. You might as well not be doing anything. No, and I have colleagues that think that way. The most effective modality is one that you're going to do. If you really dig the elliptical, go dig it. Just go do it. Get on there. If you really want to get in the pool and move around and do water aerobics, I'm fine with that. But you actually have to do it. If what you want to do is go for a walk every night with your partner or your dog or both, fine, go do that. But do it. You have to do it. So the most effective modality is one that you'll do and one that's easy to incorporate into your life. You don't want to join a gym, you have issues, you don't want to be in a gym with people, you're uncomfortable, that's fine, you don't need to. Just go walk around. We have a beautiful, gorgeous campus. Go walk around it, find people that are smoking and make fun of them. I mean, just walk around campus. That's all you have to do. It has to be easy to incorporate into your life. What are the recommendations? The American College of Sports Medicine, that's what the ACSM is, the American College of Sports Medicine, it's the really the primary governing body for this sort of thing. It's who comes up with these recommendations. I'm a fellow of the college, and we work on these things and come up with these recommendations based on a lot of research. So the minimum recommendation for aerobic exercise is 30 minutes on most, if not all, days of the week. So what I say to people is, you give me 6, I'll give you 1. But you gotta give me 6 days. I'll let you have 1 day off, okay? If it's good enough for the Lord, I guess it's good enough for exercise. So, you give me 6 days, I'm gonna give you 1 day off, that's fine. But you gotta give me 6 days. And you gotta give me 30 minutes. Now, if what you're trying to do is prevent weight gain, it needs to be closer to 60 minutes on most, if not all, days of the week. And if you wanna maintain weight loss, because everyone, you tell me, what's easier to do, to lose it or to maintain it once you've lost it? Oh, it's way easier to lose it. Because if it was easy to maintain, there would be no diet industry. They would all go out of business. That's why there is a diet industry, because everybody, well, not everybody, 85% of the people fail. That's the number. 85% fail. That means I've got 85% customers coming back. That's a great business model. I want people to fail if I'm Jenny Craig. I mean, let's be honest. Jenny Craig wants people to fail, because if she wanted people to succeed, she wouldn't have a business. I mean, I'm just, calling a spade a spade. So 60 minutes, 90 minutes, where are you at? This 30 minutes is the minimum recommendation. Now, I know some people when I give this talk, they say, oh my, there's no way, I'm not gonna do it, if I don't exercise at all now, you are never gonna get me to 30 minutes. Okay, fine, I don't care. I have colleagues that say, if you're not gonna do 30 minutes, why bother, I throw my hands up in the air. That's not me. My thing is, let's start with five. This is what I want you to do, if you don't exercise at all. After dinner tonight, I want you to walk out your front door. And I want you to walk for 2.5 minutes. And then I want you to turn around and walk home. And then you can sit down. I want you to give me 5 minutes. And I want you to do that for 2 weeks. And then, at the start of the third week, we're going to crank it all the way up. Ready? To 7 minutes. I want you to walk out 3.5 minutes and come back. Get them going slowly. Them is you, get yourself going slowly. You don't need to start at 30 minutes, but you do need to start. Because if you don't, you're killing yourself, which I'll show you later, very clearly. But go easy, just get yourself, you don't just start speaking Italian if you don't know it. You don't just start exercising if you don't do it. Get yourself into it slowly. If you're kind of there now, but you're thinking, oh man, 30 minutes all at once, I'm not sure. Okay, we know from a lot of research that from a health perspective, not from a fitness perspective, from a health perspective, 3 10-minute bouts are as effective as 1 30-minute bout. 2 15-minute bouts. So I say to people, okay, can you give me a 10-minute walk in the morning? Can you get up for 10 minutes during the day and walk around the oval? And can you give me 10 minutes after dinner? Oh, I can do that. There's your 30 minutes. We're good. There's your 30 minutes. It does not have to be continuous. Now, if you say to me, I want to get good at running races, I want to be more athletic, okay, now we need to start doing things continuous for a longer period of time. But frankly, I don't care about that. I want people to be more healthy. I want people to exercise and move more so they're healthy, so they lower their healthcare costs, and so they lower all of our healthcare costs. That's what this is all about, not making people athletes. So people are always curious about this. So well, how many calories am I gonna blow up? Well, we know rule of thumb is running, and I should put running slash walking because there's really not much of a caloric difference burn. Running or walking a mile, riding a bike indoors or outside, riding a bike about 2.5 miles, or swimming a quarter mile, 0.25, all of those things burn about 100 calories. Burn about 100 calories. Okay, all those, whether it's running or walking a mile, riding 2.5, swimming a quarter mile, they all burn about 100 calories. And honestly, the biggest variance we see is in swimming, because swimming is, if you're someone who's a very effective, swimming is very technique driven, right? I mean, you see people that know how to swim really well, they just kind of glide through the water, then you watch me, I call it controlled drowning, right? So I'm actually burning a lot more calories because I'm in there like fighting with the water trying not to drown. So I actually burn more calories. If you're a really good swimmer, you're around 100. If you're me, controlled drowning, you're considerably more because you're just trying not to drown, basically, okay? So, but they're all roughly 100 calories. For prolonged weight loss, you need consistent daily exercise. And honestly, you guys, and again, I don't want to beat people up. That's not consistent. Today you got 30, you know, oh, I feel so bad, Dr. Devor, I only did 10 minutes today. You did something though, right? Good, that's what we want. Just move more. Just be consistent, that's what this is all about. Moderate reduction in caloric intake, you eliminate creeping obesity. Eliminate 30 calories, burn 30 extra a day, now a year later. Now I know it's a year and it's only 3 pounds, but you know, just think back in the last 10 years. If you'd have lost 3 pounds every year the last 10, you'd be sitting here now 30 pounds later. Most of you would be like, hell yeah, 30 pounds less, I'll take that. It's not gonna happen overnight. There's no pill, it's not sexy. Eat better, move more. That's what you have to do. If anybody tells you anything else, they're lying to you and trying to sell you something. Eat better, and less, and move more. That's the prescription, real in a nutshell. What about this weightlifting? What about this whole resistance training? What do I need to do there? And why do I need to do that? Well, we know that resistance training positively influences bone density. It's a stimulus for calcium absorption. Osteoporosis prevention. I talk to women in my office and women in the community, and they're like, okay, I've read enough magazines now, I get it. I need to be lifting weights. And I need, you know, my bone density, I need calcium. So, and I have become a calcium eating machine. I mean, like, I eat yogurt like it's my job. I have cheese. I have a calcium pill. I'm eating dark green leafy vegetables. I'm consuming milk by the day. I'm calcium, calcium, calcium. My response is twofold. One, that's great. If you need more calcium in your diet, chances are. But two, do you do any resistance training or any weight-bearing aerobic exercise? God, why would I want to do that? I might sweat. I don't exercise. Well, then guess where all that extra calcium is going? As I like to say to my students, even though I'm being filmed, it just makes really expensive poopy. Because all that calcium is just going right out the back end. If there's no stimulus to pick up calcium, your bones are not going to pick it up. So you guys, we usually think of weightlifting, resistance training, as being very good for our muscles, build muscles, all that sort of thing. Resistance training is also very good for your bones. It makes your bones absorb calcium and keeps them dense, keeps them strong, so you don't get osteopenia, which is on the continuum to getting osteoporosis. So it's a stimulus for calcium absorption. Obviously, it influences muscle mass and strength. It helps with your metabolism. And for older adults, we know it's very good for them maintaining balance and, again, functional status, being able to do the activities of daily living, the ADLs. Maintaining muscle mass is where it's at. I say to older people that we work with, if you're over the age of 70, and they say, well, you know, I don't know how I ever had time to work. I'm so busy now that I'm retired. Okay, I get it. Grandkid, doing this, that, the other. Bald guy, I'm not going to do both the cardio and the resistance training. So which one do you want me to do? Resistance training. If you're over 70, it's all about maintaining muscle mass. That's what's going to keep you out of the nursing home. That's what's going to make it so you can climb the steps in the shoe and watch your grandkid graduate. That's what's going to maintain your functional status. And for most people, when they do resistance training, they get a little bit of a cardio response anyway, so I know that's happening anyway. So resistance training is very important. There's a significant correlation between muscle strength and independence, and again, these abilities to perform activities of daily living, and something that we call, that we measure in the lab, called preferred walking speed. Now, this is a high-tech test. We put an older adult in a big room like this. We put an X in one corner and an X in another corner. And we say, all right, Marge, I want you to walk from here to there. And I'm going to measure. That's my kind of research, right? How fast did you walk? And what we call that is preferred. And you say to the older adult, no, I don't want you to show off for me. I don't want you to try to sprint. Just like, imagine you're walking to the mall with your friends. What's your preferred walking speed? And there is a 92% correlation between the strength of the muscles in your legs and your preferred walking speed past the age of 60. You get to 60, there's a 92% correlation with the strength of my quadriceps and hamstrings. Strength in my legs, and my preferred walk. The stronger my legs are, the faster my preferred walking speed is. My gait velocity increases, which is what we want. We want to maintain that muscle mass. And again, you eliminate shuffling in older adults. How many of you know someone who does this, they shuffle, an older adult? Why do you think that? You don't learn that in old man school. Like, that isn't a lesson in old man school. Why do you think that happens? Well, the gait cycle is this. It's hip flexion. You have to flex your hip, and you have to flex your knee. So it's hip flexion and knee flexion. So it's using your hip flexor muscles and your hamstrings. Now, it's not that exaggerated with every step you take, but you have to lift your foot up a little bit, and you have to flex your knee, otherwise you drag your toe on the ground. You guys, imagine, it's hard for people that are younger. Imagine having so little strength in your hip flexors and your knee flexors that you can't pick your leg up anymore. So what do then? You do this. That's why older adults shuffle. Not because they want to, not because it's attractive, it's because there's so little strength left in those muscle groups that they can't even do a normal gait cycle anymore. Because there's, and where are you going after shuffle? Because you're not going to shuffle very long. After shuffling, where you're going is, you're sitting down and you're pushing yourself in a wheelchair because you don't even have enough strength to shuffle anymore. Or rather, you're getting pushed around in a wheelchair. And if you're in a wheelchair, you definitely don't have enough strength to stand up, which means you have a free pass to assisted living. That's what it's all about, maintaining muscle mass. So what are the ACSM recommendations for resistance training? 60 to 85% of your 1RM. What do I mean by 1RM? That's your one repetition maximum. So let's say for a flat bench chest press. Does everybody know what I mean by a flat bench? Let's say for a flat bench chest press, The most you can do one time is 70 pounds. That's your one RM. That's as much as I can do one time, your one repetition maximum. So what I want you to do is take 60 to 85% of that, do 1 to 2 sets, 8 to 12 repetitions, you're done with that exercise. That's it. 2 to 3 times a week, 5 to 7 different exercises, one for each of the major muscle groups, chest, back, arm, leg, shoulders, that kind of thing. This, notice, this is only 2 to 3 times a week, 5 to 7 exercises. Once you get a routine down, you guys, this will take you 15 or 20 minutes. Again, I don't want to create the Arnold Classic people. I want you to maintain muscle mass. I want you to just do a little resistance exercise, maintain muscle mass. This is not as often as the aerobic exercise because it doesn't need to be to get the same kind of response. So it's fairly straightforward. Again, it doesn't have to be fancy stuff. You don't need a lot of equipment. It can be body weight exercises a lot of the times. Just, again, major muscle groups. Major muscle groups, 2 to 3 times a week, 5 to 7 exercises. So how effective is this? I want to share with you some data that I collected earlier. Several years ago, or a little earlier in my career, we did a couple of studies with older adults. The first one that we did, the mean age of the participants, and this is one of the women that was in the study, and she's 91 in this picture, by the way. The mean age of the participants in this study was 87. And we had them do resistance training for 10 weeks, 3 times a week at 80% of the 1RM. Okay? So 80% of the 1RM, 10 weeks, 3 times a week. They did 3 different exercises. They did an exercise for their chest, for their back, and for their legs. Okay? And what they did was, so they did a chest press, they did like a pull down thing for their back, and then they did a traditional kind of push with the legs, a leg press. They did this for 10 weeks, 3 times a week, on Monday, Wednesday, Friday, when they could do the same weight 2 times in a row, like on a Monday, Wednesday, Friday, or Friday, Monday, when they could do the same weight 3 times per week, we would move the pin down. We would add a little more weight to it. Okay? What we saw after this 10 weeks was that the strength increased 113% in these older adults, gait velocity went up almost 12%, and their stair climbing speed, something else we measure, went up almost 30%. So again, when I hear people say, oh, you know, I'm too old for that, I'm not gonna, no, no, no. Mean age of 87. Look at these results. And look at, again, I want everyone to understand, does it do this a lot? This is a 45-pound bar with a 45-pound plate on either end. It's 135 pounds. This woman's 91 years old. That's remarkable. And look at all these young gentlemen sitters behind her. So 91 years old, Helen was in this picture. Very strong woman, very independent, very feisty, fantastic lady. Okay? So definitely, as I like to say, she gets it. She understands, she's keeping herself alive, she's not being a burden to society or her kids. So, big increases. So then I thought, well, okay, 87, that's fine, but let's work with like some real old people. So the next study, we had a mean age of 90, okay? So now this we did only 8 weeks, 3 times a week, 80% of 1RM again, so same kind of program, just 2 weeks shorter. Here the results were, strength went up 174%, gait velocity up 48%. So we even saw bigger gains. Now you guys, there's a couple, and I want to point something out, there's a couple of ways to look at this data. One way is to look at this and go, oh, here gait velocity is 12%, strength 113. Here gait velocity is 48%, strength 174. So were the 87-year-olds, were they loafing on me? Were they not really giving me an honest effort? The 90-year-olds, they were the ones busting it? No, they both were giving me honest efforts. It's called law of initial value. When you start from a lower level, it's easier to see a bigger improvement. So that sort of explains the data, but then you need to look at it again in another way. Between 87 and 90, there was a dramatic decline. Their law of initial value went way down. When you get to be that old, if you're not doing something, the rate of decline is frighteningly fast. Frighteningly fast. So it becomes even more important to be engaged in activity and staying physically active and doing resistance training. It's not just for men, it's not just with free weights, it's not just grunting in the back of the gym. It's very important to do for a lot of reasons. So, what is the medical importance of exercise? Well, we know that exercise is medicine, we know that exercise and physical activity just improve, just globally, improves health, your functional capacity, quality of life, independence, things like that. What I want to show you, the next two slides are some data that are, I think, pretty dramatic. This is exercise and the relative risk of death. We know, and it's very, very well established, that the number one predictor of all-cause mortality, in other words, the number one predictor of how likely you are to die, the number one predictor of all-cause mortality is your aerobic capacity, how fit you are. Here it is. Here's relative risk on the y-axis and non-vigorous physical activity. In other words, again, this is non-vigorous physical. It doesn't have to be really, really hard, busted it, wearing tight clothes, sweating my brains out. Non-vigorous physical activity. The more of this you do per week, this is met hours per week, it's a way to measure the amount of activity, I'm not going to go into it. The more of this you do per week, the lower your relative risk of dying is. Increased minutes spent engaged in physical activity, lower relative risk of dying. Everyone, this is data that's been collected for going on 20 years now. This is a rock solid data set. The number one predictor of all-cause mortality is how fit you are. The fitter you are, we know people live longer. It's really that simple. It really is. This is another one that I love to drive home to people, and it gets at that smoking thing we were talking about earlier. So this is a data set that was published by a friend of mine, Steve Blair, in 96 in JAMA. So yes, it's a little old, but it's an amazing data set, and the point still holds today. So what you have here is, I want to walk through this slowly. You have level of exercise on this x-axis here. A low amount of exercise, a moderate amount, or a high amount. Then on this y-axis over here, you have risk factors. Now these are risk factors for cardiovascular disease. Things like smoking, high blood pressure, obesity, high cholesterol, things like that. Risk factors for cardiovascular disease. And then over here on the left y, it's basically how likely you are to die. Deaths per 10,000 person years, okay? Real statistic mumbo jumbo, how likely you are to die. That's basically what that means, okay? So how much do I exercise and how many risk factors do I have? So I only want to focus on two bars in this whole thing. I want to focus on this front darkened bar and then this back kind of gray bar. So let's look at those two people. So this person right here has a low amount of physical activity. As I say, they don't get it. They hardly do any exercise at all. But they have no risk factors. They don't smoke, they don't drink, they're not obese, they don't have high cholesterol, they don't have diabetes. They're your friend that's skinny. And so in America, we give that person a pass. It's coming towards you in the mall, and if it's a woman and you're a woman, chances are you hate her because she's skinny. She's skinny, therefore she must be healthy. She wears a size 2 jean, she must be healthy, damn, I hate her, okay? You know what I'm talking about. But she doesn't get hardly any physical activity at all. But she's got no risk factors, so on the outside, she looks healthy, the way we define it in America. You're skinny, you're healthy, that's kind of what America does. This person, on the other hand, this is your friend who smokes, is obese, and maybe also has diabetes. Or this is your friend who is obese and also has high cholesterol. Or this is your friend that smokes and also has high blood pressure. Two are the risk factors, but this friend of yours, as I say, gets it. They're out there every day trying, they're walking around all day, they're always taking the steps, they park at the back of the lot, they even like do a little jogging, they lift it, they get it. They're highly physically active. That person has less of a risk of dying than this person with no risk factors, but that hardly does any exercise. Everyone, another way to say this is, the most important risk factor for dying is physical inactivity. It's more important than smoking. Being physically inactive kills you more than smoking does. Being physically inactive kills you more than having obesity. Being physically inactive kills you more than having diabetes. It's the most important risk factor for death. Think about that. The most important thing you can do for your health is move. Just get up, walk, move around more. This person has less of a risk of dying than this person that we give the pass to. And this person smokes and is obese and has diabetes, but they get it. They're trying every day. I know you are. Oh my God, you've got 2 cell phones and you're still all retro with your pager. Right? You're so important, you can't stand yourself. I know, you're so busy. It's got to be a lifestyle edit. And that's, I love that one because that's the one everybody's, oh, I don't have any time. Bullshit. Sorry. Yes, you do have time for exercise. It's all about, remember before you had kids? And you had all, and then you had kids and there's soccer, there's this, there's that. It's like, how did I fit all that? How do I fit all that in now? Well, you know what? You just do it because you prioritize it. You have to do it. You find the time to do it. If it's important to you, you're going to find time to do it. But it's got to be a lifestyle adaptation. This is what my colleagues, Dr. Buckworth, Dr. Potosa, talk about. It needs to be a lifestyle shift. You've got to have reasonable goals. Reasonable goals. If you don't exercise at all now, you tell me in 3 months you want to do an Ironman triathlon, that's not a reasonable goal. You're an idiot, right? I mean, you're not going to get there. It's got to be a reasonable goal. And you've got to have support of your family and friends. If you're trying to exercise and your partner is on the couch with a beer and a Twinkie every night saying, come over to the dark side, how hard is it going to be for you to go exercise? It's going to be much more difficult. You need to have support of your family and friends. It's got to be in your plan for the day. When I talk to executives, when I talk to attorneys, who are the most self-important people ever, and you know, and they all got, you know, all their things, it's just got to be, it's an appointment that you need to keep with yourself every day. It's an appointment that you need to keep with yourself every day. It's just got to be a part of your life. If it's a day that you brush your teeth, it should be a day that you exercise. It's that simple. You wouldn't dream of not brushing your teeth, I hope. If you do, don't tell me. You wouldn't dream of not brushing your teeth. I think, why would I not be physically active today? Why would I choose to sort of kill myself? That doesn't make a lot of sense. A lot of people choose that every day. Incorporate more movement into every day. Be inefficient. Use the steps. We've already said, talked about the elevator. It is the devil. Park at the back of the lot. I used to get on my mom about this. How many of you do this, right? You pull into the Walmart, you pull into the Kroger, wherever you're going, the mall, and you do what I call the prowl. You go up and down and up. You're trying to find that spot that's 25 millimeters closer to the door. Just park at the damn back of the lot and imagine this. Walk. What? Your fancy car is not going to get dinged then. You're going to get some exercise. It's all good. You're not going to get frustrated doing the prowl. Waiting for the competing with that other car. I see you. Just drive in. There's always spots at the back, I promise you. Just drive in and park. Drive into the parking ramp and don't be pissed off that everybody got there before you and got the low spots. Go all the way around and park at the top and then take the steps down. That's like telling, when I say that to people, they look at me like, are you some sort of a nut job? Like, why would I ever? Yeah, I'm a nut job. I want you to walk more. Imagine that. Gardener, pushbowl, walk your pet, hand, don't go to the moo-moo, hand wash your car. Everything counts. Just move around more. This is not meant to be a political endorsement, but you all know this man. He was the president, right? George Bush. He was busy. And again, I like to say this when I'm, generally with academics, it's not as big of a deal, but when I give this talk to executives or attorneys or something, they're all very busy, oh, they don't have time, yada, yada, yada. And I always say, I know you're all really busy. I know you think you're really busy, your day's really full, but this fella, thinking he might have been a little busier, right? President of the United States, his vice president was shooting people. Where was Osama? I mean, he had a lot on his mind, right? This dude found an hour every single day to exercise. As the president of the, now whatever your politics are, you've got to admire that. So I don't care how busy you think you are, I'm thinking this fellow's busier, or was busier. And he prioritizes, and Obama does the same thing. He prioritizes exercise every single day. If they can do it, dot, 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 right? I mean, you know how to finish that sentence. So, I have a solution. Emily and I have a solution. I have help. I bring you help. Our program runs something called the Faculty and Staff Fitness Program. It's been going on since 1975. We're not Johnny Come Lately to Wellness. We've been doing it like we're old school. We're the OG wellness people, right? The original gangsta. We've been doing this since 75. This program includes a full physiological evaluation. You come, you sign up for the, how much is it? 160 bucks for the whole year. Wait, there's more. Wait till I tell you what you're going to get for your 160 bucks. You're going to get a full physiological evaluation by people that actually know what they're doing, my PhD students. You're going to get an individual exercise prescription. Then you're going to get someone that follows you around and helps you if you want it. You're going to get individual training. You're going to get nutritional counseling if you want it, because now we've partnered with dietetics, and you can talk with a dietitian, a dietetic intern, and you can talk about nutrition, how to make that better for yourself as well. That's all part of the program. You get multiple physical activity options. We have a gym in the building that's connected, the red umbilical cord that goes across there, that's connected to our building, the PAS building. The ground floor of that is where our program is at. There's a very, very beautiful gym there. That's the gym that's reserved exclusively during the hours, I'll tell you, for our faculty staff fitness program. No undergraduates running around. You're not going to see your students. You're not going to feel inferior next to some hard body. It's faculty and staff. It's us, right? That's who's in there using. That's the only students can't use it. It's faculty and staff during these particular hours, and it's my graduate students in there running the program. And there's a lot of options. There's a private gym that we have, and the hours are, help me, Emily,
6 a.m. to 8 a.m.
6 a.m. to 8 a.m. every day.
11:30 to 1:30. And then Monday through Thursday, 4:30 to 6:30.
So there's three. Now, we're not a gym that's open 24/7. We can't be. We have to operate within, because other people use this space as well. But I promise you, it's a beautiful facility. Megan can tell you. It's a beautiful facility. And during those 2 hour windows, three of them a day, which is when most people exercise anyway, early in the morning, the noon hour, or after work. That's when a gym is busy. And those are the hours that we have. It's your gym if you're in this program. There's no students in there, there's no one else in there. We also teach water aerobics classes in the pools in this building. We also teach yoga classes. We teach boot camp classes. We have all these options that you can do. It's all part of the program. It's 160 bucks a year. Really, really cheap. And you get, I think even now you get all kinds of your plan for health, goodie points for it, and you get balloons and all kinds of stuff like that too. It's all part of that as well now, so that's all good. So Emily may or may not have information with her. She does not. But you can email us and we will get you information if you're seriously interested. Honestly, you guys, there are a lot of faculty and staff from all across campus that are a part of this program. If you're trying to get started, it's a non-intimidating way to do it. It's really, it's a great program, Megan.
And question, for the physiological eval,
yep.
That's any time of the day though. That's not during the
right.
Specified. Okay.
Well, I wouldn't say any time, but the windows are much wider.
More flexibility. Yeah.
The windows are much wider. I mean, it's roughly from 8, 9 a.m. until 4 or 5 in the afternoon.
Okay.
And we schedule an appointment with you. We bring you over, because before we set you loose in the gym without knowing what you're doing, we give you a full evaluation. We're going to put you on a treadmill. We're going to give an ECG. We're going to share it with your doctor. We're going to assess you on strength. We're going to assess you on flexibility. And then we're going to sit down within 3 or 4 days of that and go over all of it with you and explain exactly what it means, educate you. Then you can go in the gym and play, and we'll help you with the program. So we're going to educate you as well, not just like turn you loose and say, okay, go figure it out. Go use that medieval contraption and try to lift weights on it. I mean, we're going to tell you exactly what to do. So I like to finish with this. So this is a physician talking to us. What fits your busy schedule better? Exercising an hour a day or being dead 24 hours a day? And I always think that's very appropriate. So are there any questions? No.